TCM, the emergency medicine channel. Today we are discussing about tetanus. Tetanus is a condition where a patient will have increased muscle activity that is mainly produced by an organism called as Clostridium tetani. It's an anaerobic gram positive rod. So tetanus is produced by Clostridium tetani. Tetanus occurs when the spores of Clostridium normally present in gut of mammals, it is contaminated in the soil and it gains access to the damaged human tissue and it reaches the central nervous system and produces increased muscle activity and rigidity. So tetanus is produced by Clostridium tetani. Normally it is stored in gut of mammals, it contaminates the soil, and when the human get an injury, through that the organism enters the human body and go to central nervous system. The spores of the Clostridium tetani is present in the gut of the mammals and it comes out through the stool or to the soil and contaminates it and getting infected to a human being. When the tetanus enters our nervous system, normally it grows up there, it produces a toxin. This toxin is called as it's an exotoxin, it's called as tetanospasmin, that produces all the complications in tetanus. This toxin binds to the peripheral motor neuron terminals and enters to the axons and transported to the nerve cell body in the brainstem and spinal cord, especially anterior horn cells. There it blocks the release of inhibitory neurotransmitter GABA. This lead to increased activity of alpha neurons, producing severe rigidity in patient. Tetanus toxin induced effect mainly in the anterior horn cells. It also can occur in the brainstem, autonomic nervous system, and it is long lasting. When the patient develops tetanus, it takes 4 to 6 weeks because the recovery of these damaged nerves will take some time to regenerate. So the recovery in tetanus is taking 4 to 6 weeks. So all the complications of tetanus is due to the exotoxin, that is tetanospasmin. Now we'll see what are the predisposing factors of tetanus. The main predisposing factor in most of the patients, what we see is a contaminated wound in a non-immunized person. That means he has not taken adequate vaccination before and now he is developing an infection through a wound which is in contact with a tetanus bacilli. Now other conditions, that is a commonest cause, contaminated wounds are the commonest cause. Other conditions where you get tetanus is obstructive patients after septic abortions, neonates where the umbilical stem is getting infected, post-surgical patients, but nowadays it is very, very rare because we take all aseptic precautions before any major surgery. Patients with dental infections can have tetanus very rarely. Diabetic patients with extremity ulcers can have tetanus because of contamination to that ulcers. Patient who takes illicit drugs or contaminated needles, they can also have tetanus. Now we'll see what are the features of tetanus. The normal feature is increased muscle tone. Generalized muscle spasm can lead to conditions like they can have very stiff neck, like something like a meningitis. You can have a stiffness neck here. And another condition is called as opisthotonus and risus sardonicus. We will discuss what are these things. Then on examination of abdomen, you can see a board like rigidity, that wherever you press, the abdomen will be rigid. And patient can have apnea or airway problems like difficulty in breathing, thoracic muscles and pharyngeal muscles, severe muscle contraction can develop severe breathing difficulty. Increased tone in the masseter muscle, that is a facial muscle, produces trismus or lockjaw. Dysphagia due to laryngospasm. So these are the findings. The major problem in tetanus is increased muscle tone. Now two important conditions I will explain. These were very common in the past. Nowadays we are not seeing because many patients have taken adequate tetanus vaccination prior to any injury, so that they don't develop tetanus, so we don't see this finding. Opisthotonus is a condition where patient back muscles are completely contracted and patient will be in an arched position. That is very classically seen in severe tetanus. Another condition is called as risus sardonicus. So it's otherwise it's called as sardonic smile. A sustained contraction of facial muscle, frontalis and angle of mouth results in a grimace, or this is called as, like when you look at the patient, it will be like a patient continuously smiling at you. This is called as risus sardonicus. So this is due to muscles of facial expressions all are tightened or contracted. So patient will have a feature called as risus sardonicus. Now we will see tetanic spasm. Somebody is admitted with tetanic tetanus. Even a small trigger like a small noise or you just switch on the light, patient develops spasm. So avoid all this stimulus for the patient when you are admitting the patient. When the patient is having spasm, they have severe tonic contraction of muscles and it is painful for the patient. Patient is fully conscious. These contractions are painful. So continuously patient will have muscle contraction and pain, and they are fully conscious about the condition. And many patients will have dysphagia because of laryngospasm. You can test this by putting a spatula inside the mouth and touch the posterior pharyngeal wall. Suddenly if the patient start once you stimulate the posterior pharyngeal wall, if the patient is having muscle spasm, they start biting the spatula. This is called as a positive spatula test. If you don't have tetanus, they don't bite the spatula, you can easily take it out. So put a spatula and touch the posterior pharyngeal wall. If there is tetanus, they try to bite the spatula and you cannot remove it. Now many patients who have tetanus, who is admitted in ICU, you can see they develop autonomic dysfunction. Normally in ICU, to make autonomic dysfunction, you have to monitor the patient. Cardiac monitoring is required. You can see tachycardia, you can see bradycardia, you can see high BP, sometimes you can see low BP. All fluctuating heart rhythms and BP can be seen on monitoring of these patients. So depending on the condition, like tachycardia should be managed, bradycardia should be managed, hypotension should be managed, hypertension should be managed. Depending on the condition, you have to use different type of drugs. Now I'll discuss some variants of tetanus. Normally tetanus you have generalized muscle spasm, but some variants are there. One of the variant is local tetanus, spasm of muscle only around the wound, that is called as local tetanus. Neonatal tetanus is a condition, it occurs within 14 days of birth and manifests by rigidity, spasm, trismus, inability to suck and seizures. So this is called as neonatal tetanus. Cephalic tetanus means patient with injuries to the head or neck presents with the spasm of the head and neck, cranial nerves can be involved. Then later it become generalized tetanus. Only head area is involved in cephalic tetanus. Well, these are the variants. Now why we are worrying about tetanus is it has got a very high mortality. If you are not able to treat in initial phases, it has got a mortality up to 50%. So patients with a shorter incubation period, they have very high mortality. Patient with a longer incubation period, they have a lesser mortality. Whatever it is, it is up to 50% mortality in a patient who presents with a early tetanus. Now we'll see what are the differential diagnosis for tetanus. Normally in an emergency room, somebody come with severe muscle spasm. Most of the time it is due to a drug induced dystonia. The common culprit may be metoclopramide. Somebody develops severe vomiting, doctor may give metoclopramide. Many a times metoclopramide can present with severe drug induced dystonia. So that can mimic tetanus. Then trismus due to dental infection is another condition. Severe dental pain and patient had trismus, that is common in dental infection. Strychnine poison is another condition where you can have all features of muscle spasm. Neuroleptic malignant syndrome is another condition where also you can get increased muscle rigidity, high BP, altered behavior, all these things. But tetanus, you get a classical history that patient had injury in the past. But sometimes that may not be there, or patient may not be remembering that, or he may not be in a position to give that history. Whatever it is, patient will have severe muscle spasm, rigidity, even minimal triggers can produce rigidity in the patient. Okay, now once you admit the patient, to emergency room, you have to always take care is airway, breathing, circulation. Remember that patient, the most important problem in tetanus is severe neck muscle spasm. Patient can have tightness in the neck, patient can have difficulty in breathing, muscles in the chest can be tightened, so the expansion of lung will be reduced. So muscle spasm itself can produce hypoxemia, respiratory distress. This type of patients may require early intubation, and you have to anticipate a prolonged ventilation support for these patients. So some of these patients may require tracheostomy very early phase itself. Now, once you admit the patient, he stabilizes airway, breathing, circulation is the next problem. We already discussed that many patients will have autonomic dysfunction. Some have tachycardia, some have bradycardia, some have hypotension, some have hypertension. So that part should be taken care of. We'll discuss after that. Now we'll see the most important drug in management of tetanus is human tetanus immunoglobulin. We have to give human tetanus immunoglobulin at a dose of 3000 to 6000 units intramuscularly in divided dose, because the volume is large, you will have to give one or two doses different sites. This drug is given IM, and part of the dose is infiltrated around the wound. That can be done, and another part can be infiltrated different muscles, and it should be different site other than you give TT. So tetanus toxoid is given in one intramuscular area. That area you should not give this human tetanus immunoglobulin. So the dose is 3000 to 6000 units. Half of the dose can be given around the wound, half can be given in a site different than tetanus toxoid where it is given. All patients who develop tetanus should receive active immunization with TT injections. So that can be spaced, first dose can be given on the spot, second dose can be given after 2 weeks. And most of these patients will have severe muscle spasm. Diazepam is the best drug to be given for controlling the spasm. It's a GABA agonist. Doses like 10 to 30 milligram IV starting dose, and 500 milligram maximum can be given in an adult patient. Instead of diazepam, you can select midazolam. That can be given as an infusion protocol. So either diazepam or midazolam can be given as bolus dose or infusion. Midazolam is best by infusion protocol. Neuromuscular blocking agents can be given. The preferred drug is rocuronium. So these drugs are going to reduce the spasm of muscles. Now we have to think about antibiotics. Antibiotics are not the first line choice in tetanus, but when you control the airway, breathing, circulation problem, you give antitoxins, you give muscle relaxant, then antibiotics we have to start. The ideal drug to be given in tetanus is metronidazole. The dose is 500 milligram every 6th hourly. Alternatively, you can give doxycycline, 100 milligram BD can be given. Penicillin is useful. It can be given penicillin 10 to 12 million units IV for 10 days can be given. If you are suspecting some local infection like a wound infection, you have to add another drug that may cover gram negative. Suppose you are giving penicillin, it will cover only gram positive infection and anaerobes. You have to add an additional cephalosporin like ceftriaxone or cefuroxim that can cover even gram negative organism also. Now, autonomic dysfunction, we have already explained, many patients can have autonomic dysfunction. You can treat it with IV magnesium sulfate, 5 gram or 75 milligram per kg body weight should be given as bolus, and continuous infusion at a rate of 2 to 3 gram per hour should be given. IV labetalol is a drug where you have, suppose the patient is having high BP, tachycardia, labetalol is the ideal drug. You can give 0.25 milligram to 1 milligram per minute infusion can be started for patients who is having tachycardia or hypertension. Morphine can be given in same, somebody is having autonomic dysfunction and high BP, morphine is also useful. Morphine dose is 0.5 to 1 milligram per kg per hour, continuous infusion can be given. In all patients who is having tetanus, we have to give a supportive therapy. Many patients may require endotracheal intubation. Initially itself, patient may require ventilatory support, tracheostomy may be needed very early itself, and the demand for the energy is very high in tetanus because their muscles are continuously acting. So nutritional support is mandatory. DVT prophylaxis should be given with low molecular weight heparin to all patients. Any patient who is having tetanus history, you have to give immunization by tetanus toxoid injection. Two doses you can give. First dose can be given at the site or the early when the patient is getting admitted. After two weeks, you can give second dose. So tetanus toxoid should be given for all patients, whether the person is already immunized or not. So we have discussed about tetanus. The most important clinical findings will be muscle spasm. Your aim is to control the muscle spasm, control the autonomic dysfunction. Antibiotic has got a role. Metronidazole is the ideal drug of choice for this one. Autonomic dysfunction can be managed with magnesium, labetalol infusion, all these things. Muscle spasm should be controlled with diazepam or midazolam infusion. Thank you.
Subscribe to AATCM Emergency Medicine on YouTube. Press the bell icon to follow us.